Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We continue with our sermon series, Fruits of the Spirit, as Pastor Chris mentioned. I'm going to move it up to this next slide here. I'd like this scene to pick, kind of for me, that's a peaceful picture. Evening perhaps on a lake or river, just a beautiful spot. And it gives you just thoughts of peace. What comes to mind for you? So you hear this word peace. What are some things that come to mind? If you're brave enough and at peace, share. Because maybe talking out loud does not bring you peace, so it's okay. What gives you peace? What comes to mind when you hear the word peace? Home? Calm. Okay, calm. Allergies are kicking in, by the way, so what I hear and what you say may be two totally different things. What else? What gives you peace? Or what comes to mind when you hear peace? Contentment, okay.
Silence.
There's much peace here. That's good. There's much peace. Good. Okay. We could go on. I'm hoping something is coming to mind. Sorry, getting this microphone adjusted. Something comes to mind that when you think of peace, and maybe it'd be easier to say, what comes to mind when you don't have peace? Or what are some things that fail to bring peace to you? Any thoughts there?
Chaos.
Good. Yeah, see, look, that comes faster. That's easier for us. Chaos. What else?
Worry.
I'm hearing everything over here. This side, is it? Anything? What's that?
Conflict.
Good. So, again, there's all sorts of things you can think of there. Well, as I prepped for the sermon, and Pastor Chris and I were talking a little bit, there was, you know, gosh, what is there? And actually, as I started looking, New Testament especially, full of references to peace. So this was interesting. I started counting through this. In each of the 20 or 21 of the 22 New Testament letters, so as you look at the New Testament, there's 27 books. So you take out Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, in Revelation, so you take out those five books, 21 of the rest of those books either start or end with some sort of greeting that says, grace to you and peace, or grace, mercy, and peace to you, and so it was very interesting to read through that. I thought it was just going to be a couple of Paul's letters, and as I pulled up, the computer pulled up this whole long list of stuff, and so 21 of the 22 New Testament letters have this greeting in there that Paul is wishing us some sort of peace, some sort of thought there, okay? And by the way, this phrase, where do you hear it often here at church? Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hopefully you hear it at the beginning of sermons, okay? We end the sermons with, or often we end the sermons with this phrase. By the way, if you hadn't got your Pew Bible out yet, I'm going to encourage you to grab one now. Go to Philippians 4:7 to help you out there, page 982 in your Pew Bible. Okay, I should hear lots of shuffling now. That will give me peace if I hear shuffling because you've taken your Pew Bibles out to follow along with us. 982, Philippians 4, verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. When do you hear this particular phrase? Hopefully you hear it or you've heard it. It clicks in your brain. You heard it at the end of our sermon. So it's interesting that we have this habit or this tradition of beginning these words of peace with you in the end. So somehow maybe there's a significant connection that God's word is bringing peace to us. They also want you to notice as you look at that verse, the peace of God which surpasses understanding. We'll talk about that a little bit as we go along. God's peace, or this peace that God gives, does something that doesn't make sense to us, right? It passes understanding. I can't get my head around it. How in the world can we be at peace, and yet God does this peace which comes from him, and it does something. It will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. He protects us with this gift of peace. It's something we don't understand. We're not sure what's going on, and yet he promises that it guards our hearts, okay? There's another spot that we use the word peace. As you look, it's also trickled or flooded into, maybe we should say, into our liturgy. Now you're going to go all the way back to the early Old Testament. Numbers 6:26. I want you to go to page 114 in your pew Bible. Page 114. Shuffle, shuffle. Good, I'm hearing a little bit of shuffling. That's good. That makes Pastor happy. 114. I'm going to back it up. On here I've listed 26 because that's where this comes from, but we're going to start at verse 24. Hope you recognize these words. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you
peace.
Right? Numbers 6:26. This is the blessing that Aaron was told to give to the people. Aaron was the Old Testament priest. The Lord spoke to Moses. They tell Aaron to say this stuff. Aaron said this. And so we call it this the Aaronic benediction, Aaron's blessing to the people. So once again, you hear this, and of course, where does this happen in our service most often? If we use this particular one, right at the very end, right? And give you peace. So we're greeted with peace at the sermon as it starts, it concludes with God's peace. The service ends in peace. Pretty significant theme so far we see running through Scripture. One other one that I wanted to bring up. As you go throughout the New Testament, Jesus uses these words many times. So think about the different stories as Jesus heals somebody, whether it was from being, there were folks that were blind or deaf, and Jesus does something to them, leprosy. There were people he encountered, right, that had all sorts of sin issues, and Jesus would fix it, right? And some of the stories, you remember, like spitting and making mud and putting it on the eyes or whatever. There was all sorts of interesting stories of Jesus' interactions with people, and when he was done, he would say something to the effect that this has made you well, go in peace. Scripture is very interested in making sure we have this feeling of peace. It permeates it as you go through. Okay, and so I want to get with really the last two slides here. Why do we have peace? How in the world can Paul over and over encourage this peace? What is Jesus driving at when he brings this word peace to us? Let's look a little bit more. I want you to go back to Luke 2:29. Here's another story that should be familiar. Again, this is one that actually made its way into our liturgy as well. Luke 2:29, page 901. You guys are some nice, quiet church Bible shufflers. That's all right. It's quiet paper. That's good. All right. Luke 2:29. That is not 901 because Pastor got there. Thank you. 857. I looked at the wrong spot there. 857. Luke 2:29. This is Simeon. Okay. Simeon was a priest. And he was promised that he would not see death, or he was told he would not see death until he saw the Lord's Messiah. The Messiah was coming. They were waiting. They had been waiting for centuries for the Messiah to come. Okay, and Jesus is born. Parents bring him to the temple for his circumcision. Okay, they were doing what they're supposed to do, following the law of Moses. And Simeon says these words, beginning with verse 29. Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word. Look there at verse 30. So why do we have peace? Why does Simeon have peace? My eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles. Gentiles is us, by the way, and a glory to your people Israel. Simeon has peace because he has seen Christ. He's seen Christ. He has seen the Savior. This is the one that was promised. Jesus is the one who brings this peace. Now, at this point, by the way, remember, Jesus is just a what? 8-day-old baby. He hadn't done anything yet. And yet Simeon recognizes that this little baby is special. Right? It has been revealed to him that this Jesus is going to do something special. John 14:27, now page 901. Okay. This takes us farther into Jesus' story. John 14:27. Here we go. This is Jesus speaking at this point, okay? Peace, and you heard this read earlier by Pastor Chris. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Okay, Jesus is, again, bringing these words of peace to the disciples. He knows what's coming. Jesus knows what's coming. Now, as we begin to think about what, of course, all of this in peace, why did Jesus come? In terms of this peace, how is it that he brings peace to us? Not a trick question, right? Jesus brings this peace because he goes to the cross, right? And as Jesus takes our sin away, how does that make peace with us, between us and the Father? There may not be peace now as you're anxious, waiting for this pastor going to give an answer or somebody else, but we are in conflict with God because of our sin. Sin makes us enemies with him. And to have that sin over us, no matter how small, no matter how large, whatever the case is, we are enemies of God. And for Jesus to come and take the sin away, every single bit of it, removes God's wrath from us. The wrath that God was going to have towards us, the anger, the frustration, the punishment that was ours, we understand that as Jesus goes to the cross, he takes every bit of it. Right? Think about the episode of Jesus in the garden, because Jesus knows what this means. That as he prepares to go to the cross in order to make peace for us, that it will not mean peace for him. Remember in the garden, we get this description, there was much, he was filled with anxiety. Or you see this pouring out on him, or you see this worry. Father, take this cup from me, but not my will, but your will be done. And it says he was filled with this, and what is Jesus' physical reaction to everything that he knows is coming? He sweats those drops of blood. Okay, Jesus knows the anger and the wrath because of the conflict that's there. And yet, as he goes forward to do this, he does it so that there's peace. The conflict has been removed. No longer are we enemies of God because of Jesus' love. And the next question then I want to finish with today is, what do we do with this? God has given you this peace as a gift. This is the primary thing we talk of with peace. God has removed the conflict between us. He is at peace with us. We are at peace with him. What are we to do? John 16:33. Just the next page, right? We made this easy near the end here. 16:33. John. Give you a second to get there. I'm going to back up to 32 for just a second. So behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. The reality is, we can hear this in a theoretical way. We say, yes, God has given us peace. But Jesus acknowledges an important point here. We will continue to have struggles in this world. You heard the kids talk about it today. When they get in trouble, there's no peace. You started to list things that cause you not to have peace. And we begin to forget those things that God has done. And Jesus' encouragement is, yes, you are going to have tribulation. There are going to be all sorts of things that cause you not to have peace in this world. But take heart, he says, I have overcome the world. As we live by faith, trusting in all that God has done, knowing that no matter what happens in this world, no matter the tribulation, no matter the trial, no matter the struggle, as we live by as people of faith, trusting that God has taken care of all things, no matter what happens here, we know there's better yet to come. Jesus promises a world where there will be no more sin, no more tears, no more crying. He will wipe away tears from all faces. Everything will be made new. All of the struggles, all of the troubles we have are because of the brokenness that's here. The sickness that we have, the death we experience with loved ones, all of that is a lack of peace. But Jesus promises something better. And finally, let's go to Acts 9:31, page 918. What does a church look like that has peace? And I don't just mean Emmanuel at this point. This description here is for the church at large. If we are people of faith, if this peace is a gift that God gives to us, if it is living there, and if we are people that this is a gift that we have that is seen by others, listen to what he describes happened to the church that was at peace. Verse 31, Acts chapter 9. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace. Before we go further there, it was a challenge for them to have peace at this time. Remember the early church, this was a brand new group of folks doing brand new things. They had all sorts of opposition, all sorts of challenges, all sorts of people saying, you guys are wrong and crazy. Saul was after them, killing them because of their belief. Not an easy time to be a Christian. But they had peace, and it was being built up. The church was there, and walking in the fear of the Lord, fear, respect, trust in the Lord, and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. These gifts of the Spirit God gives us so that it may fulfill his purposes. And his purpose, especially here as you think of peace, is not that you get peace and you keep it to yourself. But of course, as you... The idea here is that as you go in your life and as you have your struggles, those tribulations that Jesus was talking about, and as you understand he has overcome all things, and as you have that peace, people will see it. And perhaps the Spirit works in them to ask a question, how can you be so calm? How can you be at peace in this moment? And as you share the love of Christ, and as you share that I understand there's going to be troubles, but Jesus has overcome all these things. Doesn't mean that you won't have to work to get through these troubles. Doesn't mean there won't be effort that we have to put into it, but there's a peace that, well, how does the scripture describe it? That passes all understanding. That's my prayer for you, that as you begin to understand this gift of God, that this peace that comes from him, that it will fill you so that no matter what happens from day to day, no matter the struggles, that you will remember Jesus' promise, that there is this peace that passes understanding, that he has overcome everything, that there is a better day to come, that you be encouraged with that you be uplifted, and that you be, above all things, filled with peace in Jesus' name. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus from now until life everlasting, until he comes again. Amen.